Hey everybody, I'm Nathaniel Dodson from tutvid.com, and today in this Adobe Illustrator tutorial, we're going to create this. Yep, see that? Just sliding right there across the screen, just like that. This is sort of this polar bear Arctic scene in Adobe Illustrator. We're going to walk through everything that's required to make this. I think you're going to have a lot of fun. I think you're really going to like it. And as a matter of fact, if you do like it, make sure you subscribe to this YouTube channel by hitting that subscribe button. That way you can see all of the Adobe Illustrator tutorials that come in the future. And of course, you can check out all of the Adobe Illustrator tutorials that are already on the channel. Without further ado, let's jump in and check this one out. And I do, before we get started, just have to let you guys know, this tutorial, this piece of artwork, as you can see here, it was inspired by this really cool piece that I saw on Dribbble by this user Mansoor. He's got animation and he's added blurring and depth and everything else. And I just thought it was really, really cool and wanted to give it a go in Adobe Illustrator. So check out this guy's work. I'll have a link in the description so you can go and check it out and see all the other amazing stuff that he's done. But look at that. Is that not sick? Yeah, I think it is. All right, so here we are in Adobe Illustrator. Now, I already have a file that I've created, but I would suggest that you create your own new file, and the file size is going to be this 2560 by 1440. That's exactly what I'm working with, so if you're following along, I would do that. And also, pause the video here and create a few squares filled with each of these colors. This is our color palette. These are the colors that we're going to use, and we're going to push and pull and shift these to create the scene that we saw a moment ago. So if you've got that, great. Let's get started here. I'm actually going to just double click on this layer and I'm going to call this stuff because also, by the way, on this layer over here, I have a sketch that I scanned in. And this is going to kind of be the reference sketch. It's just something, you know, on a little bit of graph paper, sketched it out. This bear standing on this little outcropping and looking at this mountain. It kind of honestly looks a little bit more like an oversized capybara, if I'm being honest. But you know, my sketching skills, they're not anything to write home about. I'll put it to you that way. All right. So here's what I want to do with that on this layer. I can probably lock that layer up just so we don't move it. And I'm going to create a new layer here and I'm going to double click on this layer and I'm going to name it artwork just so we have all of our stuff here on this layer. The bear layer, that's just, I've already drawn out the bear from a reference image, but we'll get to that when we get to that. Here on the artwork layer, we need to create our background. So grab the rectangle tool and click a single time. Now the size of our document is 2560 by 1440. So I'm going to choose that and hit okay. And then I'm going to grab my selection tool, select the rectangle, and I'm going to come up here and choose the align to, and I'm going to align this to the artboard, and I'm going to align it to both the horizontal and vertical centers, just like that. And we want to fill this with a gradient. So I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to choose my gradient dialog here, my gradient panel, and I'm going to click on that gradient. Now, it's not at all anything like we need, but I am going to change this to radial, and we're going to start changing some colors. So here with this white slider, I am going to just select it, and then up here in the color panel, from this top flyout menu, I'm going to choose RGB because what I'm going to do is I'm going to punch in a hex code right here. And the hex code is going to be this very, very light pinkish purpley color, the F0CEF7. So let's go F0CEF7. And I can click down here in the gradient panel and you can see there our center color is set. And then I want to choose the black slider here. Once more, we're going to set our color panel to be RGB, and the color we're going to choose here is going to be this color here, 7133A0. So we're going to go 7133A0, just like that. And you can see we've got our background beginning to take shape here. But what I want to do is I want to grab my gradient tool over here, and I want the center of the gradient to be down here, kind of at the bottom center of the document. So I'm going to click there, hold down shift. I'm going to drag upward, kind of like that. Maybe I got to drag upward a little further. You know, I'm going to begin the gradient right there. I'm going to drag upward like that. Nope, I'm going to drag upward a little further. I still got to drag upward further. Drag up. Nope, that's too far. So we're just going to keep tweaking it here. All right, there we go. What I'm looking for is just a bulk of this light pink in the middle with just kind of some dark in the top corners. I can also grab the kind of center gradient constriction device here, and I can either boost the amount of dark purple that I'm seeing or lighter stuff and just adjust it and kind of perfect it just like that. So that's probably close enough to what we need. I am now going to use my selection tool, select this rectangle, and go Edit, Copy. And then I'm going to choose Edit Paste in front to just drop a second copy of this rectangle right on top, just like that. And we'll set the fill back to just a solid color. So we just have the solid purple. But we do want it to have a gradient. I just want to kind of show you here. We're going to totally reset. What I'll do is I will double click to open my swatches panel, and we'll just go back to a standard black to white gradient. Collapse the swatches panel. And then here with this black to white gradient, I want this super dark purpley blue color. That's what I want. So I'm going to select my white gradient stop here, and I'm going to punch that in. So we got 27. 07 40, And we'll do the same for the other, the black color stop here. So 270740. And the one color stop here, we're going to set the opacity of it to 0%. So basically we have this very dark purple going to transparency. And then I'm going to set the angle here to 90 degrees. Now, 90 degrees puts this darkness at the bottom. We want the darkness up at the top. So let's set this instead of 90 degrees, we'll just go negative 90 degrees. And there we go. And what I'll do at this point is I'll probably stretch this up above because I want the darkness just to come down from the top a little bit, but it's a little bit too intense right now, right? You see how it's a bit much. But the problem obviously is going to be if I extend this beyond my artboard, well, I've got all kinds of issues because I'm going to have art and stuff hanging out over the gray area, my working area. I don't want that. So we'll have to mask our overall layer. We'll do that in a moment. For now, this looks about right. I'm going to go to my transparency panel and set the blend mode for just this dark purple gradient to overlay. Now, before we go any further, let's mask this in this entire artwork layer because we are going to be drawing a little bit out in the gray area. This is actually going to be pretty easy. Select the bottom rectangle and we'll just copy it. So we'll go edit copy and then specifically select the artwork layer by hitting that little circle in the layers panel. There you go. We've selected the artwork layer itself. So we'll come up here to the transparency panel, double click on the little thumbnail for the mask and you can see it's filled with black, which makes everything disappear. We're going to leave it as black, but we're going to go edit, paste in front to paste that rectangle back in. Now, we will just select the solid color layer, which is this, you know, very heavy purple, which is going to hide virtually everything. But up here in the color panel, we can really just go ahead and click on this white, and that's going to fill it with solid white. You can see our mask. Yep, solid white. We need to click on the thumbnail here for the artwork to get back to the working artwork. Now, any piece of artwork we create that ends up on this layer, well, guess what? It's not going to be allowed to show up out here in the gray area. So next, we want to begin creating some of the elements in our illustration. I like to begin with the foreground stuff. So we're going to sort of create this big rock in the foreground and the hillside that the bear is going to be standing on. At this point, you could turn the grid on if you think that will help you. You can go view, show grid. And by the way, if I'm going to show the grid, I'll probably snap to the grid. And just in general, I like to have smart guides turned on. I would recommend you turn the smart guides on because we are actually going to use them in a little bit. They're going to be really super helpful. And my grid settings under Illustrator preferences, guides and grid, are just a grid line every 50 pixels with one subdivision. So that's the way I'm working with the grid if you're interested in following along. I'm going to grab the pen tool here. And we're going to make sure we deselect any artwork that may be selected. You can go select, deselect. And I don't really want a fill for this shape. I think I want to work with just strokes and then I'll swap everything to a fill. So right now I've got a white fill and no stroke. I'm going to hit the little swap fill and stroke. And let's go ahead and begin working. I'm just going to look at my reference image once more. So we're going to kind of go up and over. You could straight up trace your image, but my image is not quite the same aspect ratio. I mean, I guess I could transform it, stretch it, and scale it. But we're going to wing it a little bit. So because I have snap to grid turned on, you can see it's just going to snap all this stuff right into place. So we're going to begin creating kind of what's going to be the first rock here. Let's bring that down a little bit, and then we'll notch it back in, and then bring it over and out, and then just bring this down like that. All right, great. So this will be our first rock. And you can see, by the way, nothing. If I set the fill color to white, nothing outside of the mask area is going to appear because it is masked. So that's great. We might actually leave that as solid white. I think I kind of like that. All right, and then over here where the bear is going to be standing, we're going to begin this up here, and we're going to pull out some tangent handles because we're going to make this a little, we're going to give it a little bit of a curve, maybe just a little bit. Doesn't have to be too much of a curve. Just enough that it kind of makes sense when the bear is standing up there. Something like that, probably. I'm going to hold down my Alt or Option key. I'm targeting that little tangent handle, which is sprouting out of that anchor point. If I hold down Alt or Option, I can adjust it. So I'm going to pull it out a little bit more. I'm going to hold down Alt or Option and adjust this tangent handle a little bit. I'm trying to basically make more of a flattened hill up here before it heads down and kind of curves into where the rock is. Right, something like that. And then the rest of this shape doesn't really matter nearly as much. Hold down our Alt or Option key and click on that anchor point to just suck the second tangent handle back in. And then we can just create a shape that we know is going to just cover the rest of what's going on here. Now, part of the problem is it's hard to see what shape is what because, I'm going to shut the grid off, by the way. The hotkey for that, as you can see, is command. Where's the show grid? There it is. The command or control and apostrophe key. What I like to do when I'm just creating my base shapes is create them with varying shades of gray so I can still see the differentiation. So I'm going to do that right here. We're going to go to the HSB, hue, saturation, brightness color view. And here we can just use our brightness and do whatever we want. So I'm going to go like 75% for that. And for the piece next to it, I'm going to go like 65% just so I can see, all right, there's the differentiation. I think I want this rock to be in the foreground. So I'll select it, right click, choose arrange, and I'll say bring to the front. That'll make sure that it's covering up, you know, and we're not having that crazy angle on the end of our little hillside showing. So we've created our two first shapes, and now I want to create these two pieces of like mid ground, right? So we're going to kind of have a little bit of mid ground going between this angled part of the rock into the hillside. So let's turn the grid back on, command or control and the apostrophe key. Grab the pen tool. And let's begin right here and pull out a little anchor point and then just create, you know, you can really make this as curved or not curved as you like. And then I'm just going to loop this right around just like that. And we're going to set this, not to 65%, we'll make this a little darker. We'll go 55% again so we've got differentiation. But it doesn't look real because it is in front of our rock and our foreground hill. You can see the new layer showing up on top. So we want it bump this down to the back. This is where these hotkeys really become important. Not really important, but they can really be a big time saver. Up under Object Arrange, we have this Bring Forward or Send Backward, and it's just Command and the left or right square bracket keys. You see that? Those are going to be really helpful. So we can just choose Send Backward, and you can see it sends it behind the rock. And then we hit Command and the left bracket key once more, and it's going to send it behind the hillside as well. So now let's grab the pen tool and let's draw one more piece. You can see how we kind of have this little rolling hill going on behind there. Let's create that here. So I'm just going to pull this up. I'm going to dip the rolling hill behind there. And then we'll have the hill pop back up here and sort of roll into, no pun intended, our bigger hill. There we go. And we'll seal that off. And then we'll just use Command and the left bracket key and just nudge it a bunch of times until it gets all the way to the back. And you can see, there we go. It's all the way in the back. And Command apostrophe to shut the grid off. And we're beginning to build our landscape now. So now it's time to draw the mountain shape. So again, we'll reference our grid. We can kind of see we're going to have a small peak and then the biggest peak and then like another peak right over there. I don't know if you can sort of see the peak peering up over his shoulder. These are trees over here. But that's meant to be sort of like a triple mountain peak. And once I think I have an idea of what I'm doing, maybe I'll even zoom out a little bit. I'll turn my grid back on and let's begin trying to create our mountain. I'm going to make sure I place the base of the mountain way down below where the horizon is going to be. So I'll begin over here and I'm going to draw sort of what's going to be the first peak. So maybe I'll make the first peak about right there and then I'll make it come down a little bit. We'll push this mountain peak over and you can see this mountain is going to have like varying angles to it. So it's going to kind of be a little angular. There we go. Let me undo that actually. I want to make that a little wider and then I'll pull it down, make it steep like that. And then I'll have this mountain shape come over and be a little bit taller than the original mountain peak that is. And this mountain's going to be a little kind of, you know, just sort of standard, if you will. There we go. And then I'll pull it way down here and then pull it down and over and over and over and then reconnect that. And now obviously it looks a little funky because number one, there's no definition in it, but also because it's in front of everything. So Command and the left bracket key until it appears to be in the back. That's great. And by the way, these two other shapes, they're starting to look darker because we're actually pushing them behind that gradient rectangle. I don't want to do that. So let's grab both of these layers here in the layers panel, holding down shift and selecting both layers, drag them in front of that rectangle. And we need to change the color of these to give these a little differentiation. So we'll select that middle ground first. Let's go from 55 to like 45. There we go. And then the mountain will take it from 55 to 35. So that is differentiated as well. In fact, actually, let's make this brighter. Let's push this up to like 85. There we go. Something like that. You can see now our distinct layers that we're creating. And before we do anything else, I want to duplicate this mountain. As long as you like the mountain shape you've gotten and you're cool with it, select it and just go edit, copy, and we're going to paste it in front. And you can see I've got two copies of it in my layers panel. I'm going to double click this top one and I'm going to name it Mountain Highlights or something like that. Not Mont, I meant to say MNT, Mountain Highlights. And then I'm just going to shut that off. We'll come back to that in a little bit because right now I want to create the moon. So I'm going to turn on my grid once more. That's Command or Control and the apostrophe key. We're going to place the moon somewhere up here. We will grab our ellipse tool. I'm going to hold down shift and I'll place the moon like right here. How big should the moon be? Maybe like that. That'll probably be a big enough moon probably. And maybe I'll nudge this down. Yeah, I'll nudge it down one. Yeah, don't stress too much about the location of it, but I think that's good. I'm going to shut off my grid for a quick second. We're going to give the moon its fill, and its fill is going to be this F0CEF7. So grab the eyedropper tool and simply click on that. But you can see what happened. When I clicked on that, I get this gradient, and it's that really dark purple to transparent gradient. So what I'll do here is I'll grab my stuff layer. I'm actually going to collapse the artwork layer here and just drag the stuff layer up on top and drop it up there. It's fine. It can remain locked. That's cool as well. Now you can see I've got the ellipse still selected. Now we'll just use our eyedropper tool, select that really light pinkish purplish color. And there we go. We have our moon. And now what I want to do before I do anything else, I want to duplicate the moon. So we'll go edit, copy, and I'm going to go edit, paste in front. And I'm going to set this to the blend mode of screen. So right there, screen, it makes it basically solid white. And then I'm going to reduce the opacity down to like 65%. You got like 65, 75, 85, something like that. Whatever looks good to you. Now I want to grab the bottom moon layer, so this lower ellipse, the original ellipse we created, and I want to go object and choose path and choose offset path, and I want to offset this path by, that's it, 10 pixels is perfect for this size moon, that's great, and I'm going to hit OK. Now we've just created an additional copy of the moon, you can see there it is, but it's like it's expanded 10 pixels. So I want to just select that and reduce the opacity of this to 25%. So this is going to be sort of like a ring of light around the moon. But you know what? One looks pretty cool. Let's try another. We'll go object path, offset path. And you can see I've selected the biggest shape. So we're actually going to expand to 10 additional pixels. And you can see there we go. We've expanded again. And all of those settings hold true because we've duplicated that original path, basically. So it's now still at 25% opacity. We have two rings at 25% opacity. Let's select the lowest ring and let's give it a third ring. Object path, offset path, 10 pixels again, hit OK. And there we go. We have a nice little moon that we've created that's hanging out in the sky, and it's kind of colorized the way we want it to be. Now, because we've locked up our background, I can just drag a selection over my moon, and I'm not going to move the background or select the background. Got the moon and all of its rings. Let's go object group and just group all these together in the layers panel, and we can name it moon if we so wish. So this looks good. Let's go ahead and begin adding color to these other elements because they're looking just a little out of place being solid gray. Let's select the mountain. We'll begin with that. Grab the eyedropper tool. The color for the mountain is this DA8EF7. That's great. Let's go ahead and select the kind of the middle ground that's closest to the mountain. And using the eyedropper tool, we're going to choose the 7342 D8 color. That's great. I'm going to go back to my selection tool. Let's grab the other piece of middle ground and grab the eyedropper, and we're going to go with the 7133A0. And then for the two closest pieces of foreground stuff, they're actually both going to be the same color, and they're going to be this darkest purple-blue color, 0D0D33. So we can see we're really building out the scene. With a little bit of definition, it's going to start looking pretty, pretty cool. One thing that I want to do before we forget about it is select the middle ground that's kind of making up part of the horizon here at the base of the mountain, and we're going to add a drop shadow to this. So we'll go Effect Stylize Drop Shadow. And this drop shadow, really, we want it to be more like an outer glow, but we want it to be pushing glow upward, sort of off the that horizon line, if you will. I'm going to set the color here to white, and we're going to make it kind of crazy. Oh, let me try that again. I did get the color white. I'm sorry. I'm going to go offset. Doesn't need to be anything. That can just be zero. The Y offset, we want that to be like negative 50. We want this to go upward, not downward. And then the blur, we want it to be even more. So we'll go like, 85 pixels. Let's try that. And we want to set the mode to normal. Let's preview this. It'll take a second because it's a giant blur that the computer has to render. And you can see we have this really cool glow happening. I think what I'm going to do is just push the opacity up to 100%. We're going to make it extreme. And that looks great. I'm going to hit OK. And there we go. We've got our little glow happening there on the horizon. And then you can see it's going to affect everything, even behind the hillside here and over here behind this foreground rock. That's pretty cool. I'm just going to back out a little bit. And now it's time to create the trees. You see, we got all these trees that are going to go here on the left and the right behind the bear. Here's how we're going to create them. Let's do this up here on the stuff layer, but I'm going to unlock the stuff layer so we can access it. We're going to create three different trees and just kind of mix and match them. So grab the pen tool and hold down shift and just to create a straight line like that. And then, wherever you want, just, kind of draw a rough triangle like that. That'll be our first tree. And then we'll make another tree that's a little bit more kind of, what's happening here is we're clicking to our grid. So I'm going to go view. I'm going to shut snap to grid off for a little bit here. We're gonna make a tree that's a little bit different shaped, right? Something like that. The key is you really want every tree to have a bit of a flat top, right? It might not make a lot of sense, but you'll see why in a moment. I'm going to pull that over and just drag that right across. And having Snap to Guides turned on will also help ensure that I'm keeping my lines pretty straight. All right, let's go like this. And let's do a little bit more of like a traditional shaped tree, something like that. And it does not at all have to be perfect. You can just kind of go through and rough it, because you'll see in a second, we're going to literally roughen this stuff up quite a bit. All right, that's close enough. Now what I want to do, I'm going to select my initial tree, and I'm going to go Effect, Distort and Transform, Roughen. And the roughen that I want, I'm going to turn Preview on because I really want to see this. That's way, way too much. I want to increase the detail though. So I'm going to go like 35 in the detail department. I want the points not to be smooth. I want them to be corner points, very sharp, needly. Think a pine tree, an evergreen tree, something like that. But the size needs to be small. I'm going to go 0.5%. You can see we get these tiny little things. Maybe I'll go a little bit more than 0.5. What does 1% look like? 1% is kind of cool. I'm going to hit OK with that. And let me take a closer look. You know what? I may actually take my direct selection tool and grab one of these corner anchor points and just pull it up a little bit to give the tree a little bit more of a point. Something like that. I think that's cool. All right, that's our first tree. Let's select our second tree here. Let's go Effect, and we're going to just choose Roughen. Not Apply Roughen, but Roughen. That's going to bring up the dialog box for us. Hit Preview. Make sure we turn Preview on. And I'm going to increase the detail up to like maybe 55. I'm going to increase the size to, probably 2. I'm going to hit OK here. And with this one, I'm looking here. I probably shouldn't have done a flat top on this either. Don't take my advice for the flat top. I think it looks a lot better if we take it to pretty much a point. If you go too much of a point, you're going to see how we have a weird shape up at the top. We don't want that. I'd rather have a little bit of scrambled something. All right, and then we'll select this next shape, and I have a feeling this shape is going to give us some trouble. I'm going to make it a little bit more kind of long and thin like that, and just preemptively, I'm going to make it a little bit more pointy. So something kind of like that. All right, we'll take this. We'll go Effect Roughen. I'm going to turn Preview on, and I'm going to go with like 0.5, 0.6, something like that. In detail, should I push it up? Should I push it down? Yeah, I'll go to like 63. That's fine. And then I'm going to adjust the shape of the tree a little bit more, just to make it kind of more perfect. You know, it doesn't have to look perfectly like a tree, but maybe we do want it to have a little bit of detail that's somewhat realistic, something like that. And I'll collapse it and make it a little bit narrower as well, something like that. All right, cool. So basically, we have a few different tree shapes that we can mix and match here. I'm going to select these three trees. Let's give them a fill. Hey, if you're on Instagram and you're following along with this tutorial and you've gotten to this point, number one, follow me over on Instagram at Tutvid. There'll be a bug that pops up somewhere here on the screen. And also, if you do finish this tutorial and make your own piece of art, I would love to see it. Upload it to your Instagram, and you don't have to give me some elaborate shout out or anything fancy. I mean, if you do, that's fine. But the most important thing is that you tag me in the image. That way it goes to like my tagged images, and I don't lose you in my like notification stream there in Instagram. And I'll be able to like it and comment on it and, you know, all that kind of good, fun, cool stuff, and see what you make from this tutorial. They may have the right fill, but just to make sure, I'm going to sample. I want this 7133A0, and they didn't have the right fill. Now they have the right fill. That's cool. I'm going to select them once more, and I want each of them to have the opacity of 90%, just so they're slightly see-through, so there's a little bit of interaction when they kind of bump into each other, so you can just see the overlay. All right, let's begin now. I think this is the nicest tree, so this will be our primary tree, and we'll just randomly mix in a couple of these other trees, as long as they don't look absolutely horrible. So I'm going to hold, I'm not going to hold down anything. I'm just going to copy this. I'm going to go copy, and I'm going to lock up my stuff layer. I'm going to come back to my artwork layer here, and I'm going to hit, I'm just going to go edit paste. Let's just see what this does. Edit paste. It's going to drop it somewhere in the middle of our document. Great. And we've got our tree here. Now, things are looking a little weird because you can see we can slightly see through the tree. It's way too big, and we can see the rock, you know, that's right there behind it. Don't worry about exactly the arrangement of the tree, the fact that it's on top of all the other layers. We'll fix that in a moment. Hold down Shift and just scale this tree down. Let's make it small. And there we go. We'll place our first tree. So there you go. We got our first tree. Really difficult to see at the moment. We'll help that. We'll help change things enough so that we can see it in a little bit. Maybe we'll brighten up the background a little bit. That might be the answer. But let's go ahead, hold down Alt or Option, and just duplicate this tree. And I'm going to stretch it straight up to make a little bit of a taller tree next to this. And that is kind of difficult to see. You know what? Before we go any further, let's go back and select our background rectangle. Select that. And go back to the gradient. And let's just increase the power of the lightest purple here. See how we're just brightening everything up with the lightest purple? And we're just going to kind of limit that purple around the edges a little bit more. And you can see already we're seeing a lot more. That's cool. something kind of like that. That's probably just about perfect. Cool. I'm going to just collapse gradient. And I'm going to come back up here where I'm working on my trees. And I'm going to hold down Alt or Option. I'm going to duplicate that tree. I'm going to make a little tiny tree there. I'm going to select one of the bigger trees up here too. Well, I need to unlock the stuff layer. I'm sorry. Select that. And we'll go Edit Copy. And make sure we lock up the stuff layer. Come back down to our artwork layer. And we'll paste this guy in place. That's Command or Control F. Let's zoom in. Let's see what one of these trees looks like. It might be a little ridiculous, but we'll just size it down. Maybe make it nice and narrow. We'll make that piece of the forest stick up right through there. I'm going to grab another one of these trees. I really want it to look like there's a lot of little tiny trees too. It doesn't have to be, like everything doesn't have to be this giant tree. So let me select over here in the layers panel. Let me select that tiny tree. I'm just going to use my arrow keys to drag it or nudge it over. And I'm going to put the tiny tree there. I'm going to Alt or Option to drag a copy of that out. And I'm going to make a forest of kind of these smaller trees. It still doesn't, it doesn't look very realistic right now, but don't worry about that. It's going to once we drag and drop this stuff behind the rock. Let's grab this big tree here. Let's throw another tree in. And I'll maybe take another copy of this guy. I'm going to scale him way down like that. And then I'll drag him up, put him in place right about there. Cool. So if I zoom out, we've got those trees there. Yeah, it might be just about enough. Maybe we'll grab a couple more of these small trees here. Alt or Option, just duplicate them over. I'll put them on the other side of kind of the hill or the crest of the rock, even though it's not technically a hill, but just throw a couple more trees in there. All right, let's zoom out. We've got the trees placed on that side of the scene. We could be lazy and just grab a bunch of the trees and duplicate them over and leave the exact positioning. I don't want to do that. I do want to select a bunch of them though. In fact, I'm going to zoom back in to make it easier to do that. And grab my selection tool and just hold down Shift and make a selection of a bunch of these trees, just like that. Let's zoom out. And now let's hold down Alt or Option and just drag them right over to the other side of the scene, just kind of something like that. I'm going to zoom in a little bit, and we'll just reposition these just to mix things up a little bit, keep things looking interesting. Let's add a small tree right into there. We got this small tree. I'm gonna duplicate that and make a little tiny tree. We got this big tree here. I'm gonna make a number of big trees here in the foreground. And let's take this, and I'll put one more kind of like mid-sized tree there in the middle. All right, that's probably enough in terms of forestry on both sides. Now what we want to do is we want to select all these trees and just group them together and then kind of push them behind our foreground elements to really get an idea for what this looks like. Problem is we have a lot of trees. So I think what'll be easiest is if we just lock up the rest of our layers here. So lock up the two foreground elements, the two midgrounds, our mountains, and the background that we just edited a little bit. And then just drag a selection across our artwork. There we go, we've selected all the trees. We'll go Object, Group, and now you can see we have this group. It's as if it's one layer full of trees, and just use that same Command or Control and the square bracket hotkey with the left and just nudge it until you bump them down behind the foreground elements. And you can see now it looks like we got these nice little forests that are popping up on the horizon of our piece of artwork. So now it's time to add some shape and definition to the mountain itself. It's looking awfully flat back there. Let's unlock the mountain and unlock mountain highlights, number one. Let's turn on mountain highlights and let's work with this first. I'm going to select that, and we want to fill this with a gradient. So double click to open the gradient panel. You can just click on gradient, you know, the little gradient thumbnail, and then choose a linear gradient, and we'll stretch this back. Actually, we don't even need to do that. Let's make this black to white. You know what? We can't do that. Select the gradient stop up here in the color panel. We'll just hit the color white. So we've got solid white. And then over here on this purple stop, drag it back to its place, select it, and select the color white up here in the color panel again. So we have a white to white gradient. But like we did before with that big gradient on the background, we're going to change the opacity of one of these points to 0%. So we have a white to transparent gradient happening. And I'm going to drag that kind of center point over. So we just have a little bit of a highlight. Then I'm going to grab the gradient tool. I think this will just be easiest with the gradient tool and pull a diagonal gradient this way down and across my mountains and just keep playing with it until you get the angle just right. I'm just looking to have a little bit of highlight across kind of all three of the peaks, but for sure this peak and this peak because our moon is right up here. So I think that'll work. That'll be pretty good. And if you want, you could even try setting the blend mode of this layer here, mountain highlights. We could set the blend mode to like soft light and see what that looks like. That kind of takes some of the bite out of it, but you're still getting a little bit of a highlight happening. So maybe we'll do that. We'll set that to softer light. That looks pretty good. And now let's use the pen tool and create sort of the shadow side of each piece of the mountain. So this is going to be where you just kind of, you know, you just kind of draw what you think works. I'm going to set my foreground color here to this CD84E5. So let's just sample that, set that as our foreground color. Grab the pen tool and we'll begin. And by the way, let me undo that. I didn't mean to begin drawing. This is where it's very helpful to go view and turn those smart guides on, because we're going to be following the exact, you know, basically peak here. So I'm going to begin at the peak. I'm going to come over this way. I'm going to notch back this way. I'm gonna bring this point down to like here, and then I'm gonna bring it back up and then loop it there. And then I'm gonna deselect. You can see we've created some definition on that part of the mountain. That's cool. And by the way, if you have a sketch that you did, you can see, wow, I almost did the exact shape that I did in the drawing. If you have a sketch like this, you can go in and play with that and you know, try to tweak and adjust your mountain as you see you've done it in the sketch. We wanna deselect it, we'll select, deselect. I don't wanna change the mountain. I'm going to go from this point right here, and I'm going to bring it down this way and then loop back up and bring it down and then over and down this way. And then I'll come straight up to my anchor point and bring it over and then intersect that. And we want to change. We want to make sure that the fill is not this gradient, but is our solid pinkish color. There we go. And I want to create another part on the mountain here. So I'm going to bring down off the peak here. You can see how that just adds that definition. We do have two separate shapes, so we can change the opacity and make them slightly different, or maybe make this purple slightly darker if we want to further emphasize that. That's kind of a cool option to have. All right, let's do the same thing here. Let's just create a nice little bit on the mountain. Great. I'll bring it back to there. Cool. And then also just a little something something here for this part of the mountain. We'll create a little spot there. That's kind of going to be the shadow side. I might pull the anchor point down a little bit further, just like that. And looking at it, actually, I'll pull this anchor point down, make it intersect there. And I'll probably add an anchor point. Let's zoom in here. Let's grab the pen tool. And we're just going to add an anchor point right there and just drag this over, and we'll just cause this to click right into place. Just so really that whole side of the mountain should be covered, right? If there's a shadow on the side, the whole thing should be a shadow. So that's cool. We'll do that. And you can see it's all of these shadow sides of the mountain. They're on top of our middle ground. We'll adjust that in a moment. You can see they're just, you know, because we're drawing them where we're drawing them. They're on top of everything. But before I do anything else with these, I want to select them all. So I'm just going to select them in the layers panel by clicking on the little circles and holding shift. And just click each of the little circles for each of these little pieces of shadow that we created. There we go. What are there? Five of them. Something like that. That looks good. And I'm going to duplicate these. So I'm going to go edit, copy, and then I'm just going to paste the right in front, and I'm going to group these together. So I'm going to hit object, group. And what I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to fill these pieces with a gradient. So I'm going to just hit that gradient, and you can see it's the white to transparent. I don't want white. I'm going to select the color white, and I'm going to set it to black because I want this to be, you know, emphasizing the shadow side of the mountain. So I select both color stops, make them white. It's not quite perfect, so I'm going to start playing with the angle here. So I'm going to go like shift up, but 40 degrees is not right. I need to go the other direction. So like maybe negative 30, maybe a little bit less than that, maybe like negative 25. That should work, something like that. That's cool. And then we'll go back to transparency, and we can do a number of things. We can set this to soft light. That's going to kind of settle things down a little bit. It's still maybe a little too strong, so we'll go to the opacity, and we'll set this to like 35%. So it's just a subtle effect. We're just trying to add some shape to our mountain. So I kind of like that. I think that's cool. Let's select this group and hold down shift in the layers panel and select all the other pieces of the shadow side of the mountain, and we're going to begin moving these down our layer panel. Basically, we'll move them down until they're just right here on top of our mountain highlights. So command or control and the left bracket key, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times. There we go. Now these shadow side pieces, they're just on top of the mountain and they're looking just right. And by the way, we put them on top of the highlights as well. So I'm going to deselect that. We have our mountain there. It looks a lot better because now it's got some shape and some definition. And let's go ahead and add a little shape and definition to the foreground as well. So I kind of want a little bit of light from the moon to be hitting sort of the top side of the rock. Maybe we'll add this little shadowy thing here. We'll add a little bit of light in the crotch where this hill meets the rock, just to show that the little light is being caught in there. And then we'll have a highlight here up kind of underneath or around where the bear is standing. So let's grab our pen tool. Once more, I'm gonna set my foreground color before I get going here. I'm gonna set it to this F0CEF7. I'm gonna grab the pen tool, and I'm just gonna begin drawing a shape here on top of the rock. So I'm gonna begin right over here, but we actually need to unlock that foreground rock there in the layers panel. There you go, now it's appearing. So we'll select that, and we'll just create, you know, a highlight kind of that runs right off the rock, just like that. Voila. So that'll be that highlight. Let's zoom in here on the rock. And what I think I'll do is this is going to be more of that shadow that I talked about a moment ago. We'll create sort of this little bit of a shadowy crevice. You see, if you have snap to or smart guides turned on, your pen will automatically snap to where that anchor point is, which is right there. Even though I can't see it, I know that's where it is because it snapped into place. That'll be a little bit of a shadow. And then here we'll bring our little highlight, if you will, in the middle. We'll create this. We'll give it just a little bit of an angle to go along with what we've got going on. This absolutely does not have to be perfect, but you know, hey, the more perfect you can get it, I won't complain. There we go. So that'll be the highlight. We'll use a little bit of a gradient, so don't worry about the loop-de-loo shape on the end. You'll never see it in the end. And then up here, we'll create a little something-something for the bear. And once more, our snap-to-guides is not working here because we need to unlock that hill layer. There we go. And now there we go. That looks good. Something like right about there. And let's just create this nice, you know, kind of scalloped, swooshing shape. I'm going to hold down my Alt or Option key here and pull a tangent handle out of that anchor point. Let's join these back together. And I'm just going to click and drag until it, you know, it roughly meets up. It does not at all have to be perfect. There we go. Cool. All right. And so now with our highlights, well, with the shadow, number one, we'll select that. And I'm going to use my eyedropper tool. I'm going to select the darkest color, but obviously that's not going to do much because that's the same exact color as the rock already. So I'm going to go to my darkness or my brightness slider, and I'm going to set it to like 7%, just a little bit. Well, no, it's a little bit too extreme. Let's go like 12%. That probably will work for us. We'll deselect that. Yeah, you just have a nice little shadow that's happening right in there. Cool. And we'll select the highlight here on top of the rock. And for these, all we're going to do is set it to the blend mode of soft light and then reduce the opacity. So pretty drastically, probably like 15%, maybe a little bit more. It just depends. I kind of want it to be subtle. See how that's like super subtle, but it's definitely making a difference. In fact, with this color, I'll probably set this to soft light as well and just see what that looks like. It's not doing that much. Let's go to opacity. Let's set this to like 45%. That feels about right. And there, that looks pretty good. Now for this, we're going to apply a gradient. So let's just knock out the highlight up here on the hillside first by setting that to soft light and an opacity of about 15% as well. So you can see we have a nice little highlight on top of the hill. Now for this in here, we're going to go back to our gradient panel. I'm going to go black to transparent. That's fine. We're going to select the black color stop here, and we're just going to hit the color white up here in the color panel, change that to white, and select the other black color stop, set it to white as well. Cool. And then I'm just going to shift the angle here. So let's go negative. Let's go like negative. Can we get to negative 35? If I deselect out here, am I seeing a little bit of circularness? I am. So let's select that. And let's just push the color white back a little bit further from the edge. There we go. See how it looks like basically a perfect fade. Now we'll select that once more, set this to a blend mode of soft light, and then just set the opacity to something like, I don't know, 25, maybe 30. We want it to be a little bit more noticeable here. I'm going to go all the way up to 40%, in fact. So you just have like a nice bit of light that's being caught there, which is going to kind of signal that the hillside is actually closer to our source of light, our moon, than this rock. So this rock is the thing that's absolutely closest to the camera, if you will. So we've built our scene. Now we're ready to drop the bear in place. So I remember I mentioned earlier we had that bear layer, and I just did this to save a little bit of time because it's just tracing an image of a bear with the pen tool. But if you go onto Google, you can find an image of a bear or, you know, whatever kind of animal that you're placing. Now this bear, I actually want it to be facing the other direction because this guy is going to be up here on the hilltop. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to cut him here. I'm going to edit cut to pop it off the bear layer. I can lock the bear layer up and hide it. Come back to my artwork layer. Let me open it up, in fact. And we can paste it anywhere. So just Command or Control V to paste him in place. And first and foremost, I want to go Object, Transform, and Reflect. And we're going to reflect along the vertical axis and hit OK. You can see now he's flipped around. So he's kind of in place. And I actually kind of like his posture a little bit. We could make him bigger. We could make him smaller. We could rotate him a little bit if we wanted to be maybe like angled upward a little bit. You can even go into like Effect, Distort, and Transform and Free Distort. And you can take and drag and say like, all right, the back side of the bear needs to be a bit bigger than the front side of the bear. So we can actually like change the perspective of him a little bit. Something kind of like that. We could hit okay. And then we can say, well, that needs to be stretched out a little bit more. And if you don't like the fact that it's a live effect that's applied to your shape, you can always go object, expand appearance. And now that's the shape. I want to rotate him downward a little bit, just like that. And I want to make him a bit smaller. So I'm going to size him down a little, and I'm going to move him into place. Kind of, sort of like that. Yeah, he's got to be a little bigger than that though, right? So I'll put him in place there. These trees behind him are not quite tall enough. I still want to be able to see a few trees popping up from behind him other than just those two. So what I might do is select him. You can see here, he's this path right here. I'm going to hide him for a second. I want to grab some of these trees and make them a little taller. So what I'll do is hold down Command or Control. I'm just using my selection tool. Command or Control and hold down Shift and just select a couple of these trees and we'll just nudge these upward. Kind of like that. Maybe like that a little bit. Yeah, something a little bit like that. You know what? I'm going to make this tree just a little shorter just to keep things mixed up and varied. All right, let's turn the bear back on. All right, and we got a little bit of something popping out up there, so that's cool. I'll move the bear into kind of what will be, I think, his final position, something like that. And what I want to do now is make the bear the same color as the foreground color. I didn't mean to move that hill, by the way. That was an accident. I'm going to select the bear. I'm going to grab my eyedropper tool, and I'm going to sample the 0D0D3, and there the bear is. And he basically is going to blend in, if not for the fact that we have that little bit of highlight there beneath his legs. So there you go. We have that. Maybe we want to see a little bit of stuff going on here so we can kind of see through his legs, if you will. So you could do a number of things. Probably the easiest thing to do here is change the hill a little bit. So we can select the highlight, hold down Shift and nudge it down 1, 2, 3. Yeah, I'll probably go down about the Shift. I was holding down Shift and nudging the down arrow key 3 times. And if we do it with the highlight, we're going to need to do it with that hill shape, which is right here. So I'll select that, hold down Shift, 1, 2, 3, just like that. And when that moves, well, our little highlight here is a little messed up. So we need to grab the highlight, select that, and hold down Shift and nudge down 1, 2, 3, just like that. And the highlight's looking good. In fact, if I deselect, it adds a little bit of something here to the piece of artwork that you'd probably want to clean this up. So we can do this pretty easily. Just grab your direct selection tool, and I'm just looking to grab that anchor point. And this little highlight's probably going to get in the way. So let me just collapse transparency and collapse color. This is where we get in tight and tweak things. This is that highlight. You can see it's selected because it's got the green box next to it. Let's just lock that up. And then we can select that anchor point. And I'm just dragging one single anchor point. And I can just drag it over and just make sure that it lines up just the way that it should. And you can see now we have our shapes come together nicely. And you can see a little bit of color between the bear's legs. And the importance of this is just that it shows off more of the silhouette of the bear. So it's even easier to identify that, hey, that's a bear. These trees do look a little funky here between his legs. Let's shut that off and see. Ah, look at that. One of the trees, the small tree, is actually sticking up above the horizon line now that we've dipped the hill down. So grab the move tool again, hold down the Command or Control key, select that one tree, and just use your arrow keys and nudge it downward until it looks about right. And I think right about there, it looks right. Let's turn the bear layer back on. Cool. That looks a little bit better. So we're coming down the home stretch. We're nearly finished. We just need to add a couple lighting effects, and we're going to wrap this thing up and get out of here. I want to duplicate the bear shape, so I'm going to select him and go Edit, Copy, and then Edit, Paste in front. And we want to fill him with a white to transparent gradient. By the way, I have this mask on the bear. You can ignore that. That was just something I was playing around with when I had the selection and didn't get rid of it before I started recording. That's not necessary. Come over here to Gradient, and I already have a white to transparent gradient that's kind of loaded in the gradient panel. Just select that. And moving from the snout of the bear, we do want that to be white. I do want to change the angle, though, so I'm going to hold down Shift and the down arrow key. I'm going to go like negative 20 degrees. That's pretty good. And then what we'll do is come over here to transparency. We'll set this to like soft light. And I think that actually, that might be good. We can leave it at 100%. And looking at that, I may want to expand actually the amount of white that comes onto the bear. Brighten him up a little bit. Yeah, because remember, he's going to be taking light from the moon that's going to come over and kind of hit him right in the face. So a little bit of that light should probably be fading around him. That looks pretty cool. Now let's create a large circle. This is where we're going to, you know, have a kind of a blast of light coming out of this at us. So we're going to just hold down Shift, create a big circle. It can, you know, be as big as you can fit onto your artboard, kind of something like that. That's cool. And we want to select the white point here on our gradient because we do still want a gradient. I want to select my white point here. And I want the lightest pink color that I have, which is this F0CEF7. So I'm going to open up my color panel here, and I'm going to jump over to RGB so I can punch in the hex code, and I'm going to go F0CEF7. Great, that's that pink. And I'm going to do the same thing here with the other slider. So what is that? F0CEF7. Cool. So we have a pink to pink, but it's really pink to transparent. And it's a little messed up because our top, you know, gradient limiter point, if you will, the location is at 30%. I just want to double click this and reset it to 50%. That brings it right back to the exact middle. But most importantly, we want to change the type of our gradient to a radial gradient. So you can see we're creating kind of this glowing ball in the middle of our scene. That's pretty cool. Once we've got that, I'm going to stretch it out sideways, this circle. So I'm going to hold down Alt or Option, and I'll just drag this straight out until we have a nice big you know, kind of spotlight effect in the middle of our document. You can see though it's knocking out contrast here on the front side of the hill and on the mountain and the bear and everything. So let's go to the transparency panel. And in order to really crank things up, we're gonna set this to the blend mode of color dodge. And you can see it's blowing the living daylights out of the middle of the image. So let's reduce the opacity to like 50% or so. And you can see here just a quick before and after, we're just getting this nice blast of light right into the middle of the document. Now, one other thing you can add that I had in my sketch are some birds. Adding a couple birds, it's gonna be super easy. I'm not gonna cover how to do it here in this tutorial, but just use the pen tool, draw a couple little paths, and that's gonna add some really nice, like, it's a nice spatial element. It adds good depth to the image. What I would rather take a little bit of time and show you how to do is some grain. So we're going to grab the rectangle tool and we're just gonna click a single time. We're gonna create another 2560 by 1440 rectangle, hit okay. And you can see it's giving us just that pink to transparent gradient that we've been using. I'm gonna fill this with a solid color though. So let's go with that solid pink. And before we do anything else, let's just align it here to the horizontal and vertical centers because that's where we want our grain to be. I can even name this layer grain. And what I want to do is fill this with a 50% gray. Now I can get that by going to my HSB and resetting everything to zero, well, the hue and saturation to zero, and then the brightness to 50. There we go, we've got a nice 50% gray. Before I do anything else with this, I am going to go edit, copy, and just simply paste this right in front. And the second grain layer, I'm gonna shut it off. We'll get back to it in a second. Select the underlying grain layer. We're gonna go effect, artistic, and we're gonna choose film grain. Now here in film grain, we'll keep it simple. We'll go film grain, we'll go 10 on the grain, zero on the highlight area, and 10 on the intensity. I'm gonna hit okay with this, and then we'll simply set this layer in the transparency panel, set this layer to the blend mode of soft light. The grain is gonna have to re-render when you do that. That's no big deal. We're gonna zoom in here and check it out. And if I zoom in, you can already see I'm getting this like grainy texture, right? That looks pretty stinking cool. It just helps take out some of like the overly perfect and overly smooth feel that the illustration is going to have. Let's turn on our second grain layer. We're gonna add some more grain to just mix things up, make it feel a little bit more organic. We're gonna go effect, texture, and we have another grain option here. And this grain, we're gonna go with, there's a lot of actually nice grains here. I'm gonna stick with the contrasty, and I'm gonna go with a 40 intensity and a 60 contrast. That looks pretty good to me. You can always play with it and see what you get. But I don't know, I feel like 40, 60, something around there is gonna work good for this. And then of course here, up in the transparency panel, we'll set this to soft light as well, which is gonna knock away that gray. It's gonna have to re-render. And this texturized grain usually takes a little bit more time to you know, process, as you can see here. It's just gonna take a second longer than the film grain, but it's really no big deal, and it's really beautiful grain. Perfect, and again, if we zoom in, you can really see we have this really rich grain that's just beautifully texturizing what we're working on here. And you can really take this, you know, a few more steps. You can enhance the highlights and shadows on the mountain. You can add even more realistic elements. You can work to make more realistic trees, add more animals, make the moon bigger, make the highlights different. There's so much here that you can adjust and change and move around and just kind of do what you will with it. It's really, really cool. That's gonna be it for this tutorial, guys. If you've enjoyed it, again, make sure you slap a like on the video, subscribe to the channel so you don't miss out on any other tutorials that are like this. So for creating this Arctic, cold, purpley, polar bear illustration in Adobe Illustrator, that's it. Get it, got it, good. Nathaniel Dodson, tutvid.com. I'll catch you in the next one. And before you go, make sure you subscribe to my channel for more great tutorials every day. Also, buy my course. It helps us do what we do, and this channel is supported by viewers just like you. You can also just click the thumbnail and watch another video from this channel. See you next time, guys.